is Thomas. All I wants to be an artist. I need help from all my demons for my dreams to get accomplished. See, Tom, I'm just what you need. We're a team. Disagree? Go ahead, cut your wrists and make your demons bleed.
No! I need to do this by myself. I told you twice already exactly how I felt.
I'm the best rapper ever. I don't want to be great. If they're the best, then I'm better. Don't you make no mistake. Cause I'm the gold. Feel it in my bones until I'm a ghost. I'm the one.
He's not the best rapper ever, but he's also right about being white. It's so interesting because in any other context, the points he was making would seem very reasonable to people. So for example, I was once at dinner with some folks who were from Ghana and Nigeria, and we got talking about the topic of slavery. And obviously, if you actually know history, you know that what happened in Roots, where black people just got kidnapped by white people off the West African coast and shipped to America, is not really what happened. In the vast majority of cases, black people, Africans, were enslaved by other African tribes, right? Captured and enslaved, no white people around. And then white people showed up and were like, we'd like to buy some slaves. The alpha tribes in Africa were like, yeah, we have some slaves. We've already captured them. We'll sell them to you in exchange for goods. That's actually how most black people who are descendants of slaves came to this country. So I was chatting with some Ghanaians and Nigerians, West Africans, and I was talking to them about how they learned about this in school, right? Like when you learned about this, when you learned that perhaps your own ancestors captured fellow Africans and sold them into slavery, how did you feel about this? Did you feel guilt? Did you feel shame? Were you taught that this is a stain on the legacy of your family that you should feel a certain way about? And what they said to me is, no, we just learned it as a neutral fact. A neutral fact. And I thought to myself, you know, that's exactly how I would feel if I were a Ghanaian or Nigerian who is generations removed from the crime of having captured other Africans into slavery and sold them. Because I didn't do it. There's something so fundamental about the agency of an individual person. Like, I'm responsible for the shit that I did. What is the biblical quote? You don't, you know, punish the son for the sins of the father. It's such a fundamental ethic. And then suddenly when it's white people in America, it's like you've never heard of basic common sense and morality before. It's like if you're white and you're born when Tom Macdonald was, you're supposed to feel guilt and shame for shit that you had nothing to do with. And I think the problem is it's so counterintuitive for most people that you're just not going to get anywhere. You're not going to get anywhere telling people to feel bad for stuff that their great, 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 great grandparents did, let alone stuff that their parents did. If we're going to have a serious conversation about the legacy of slavery and the harms caused by it, we have to view this take as an acceptable, valid take, or else you're living on a different planet. I've never listened to a Macklemore song and been like, wow, that sounds great. Or even, wow, that sounds good. Or even, wow, I'd spend 99 cents on that. But it's not because he's white. It's just because I don't f*** with his music. That's not the kind of music I like. Again, I don't follow the dude, so I can't say I'm an expert on everything he said, but has he ever said that he invented his style of rap? Has he ever not given credit to the great rappers of the past? I don't know. If he has, then that's really stupid. It's such a stupid thing for a rapper to not give credit to the rappers of the past, the vast majority of whom are black, that I think almost nobody would actually do that. So I'm very skeptical that he actually said anything like, I invented this whole style. To be honest, I'm a pragmatist in that way. So Macklemore has a massive platform, and there's a whole generation of kids, probably of all colors, who would have never heard of Slick Rick or Dougie Fresh. And it's a shame that they would have never heard of him, but that's just how it goes. It's when you're born in a new generation, you're not automatically exposed to those greats. I was exposed to it because my dad made a point of exposing me to the music he grew up on, in the 80s, including the rap and the funk and the soul. But a lot of kids who don't who had dads that listened to different shit are never gonna hear about Slick Rick. Almost all creativity is heavily borrowed from scenes and from particular people. You can go as far back as you want. It's like Charlie Parker and Sonny Stitt, the jazz greats back in, and you know, in the 40s and 50s, like they sounded very similar. You could argue they, you know, Sonny Stitt sort of bit off of Charlie Parker's flow in a way. Part of what it is to learn an art form is to learn by imitation and to learn by absorption. Let's not pretend that that's not 90% of what learning an art form is. You don't learn in school. You don't learn by reading books or by learning principles. You learn by imitating the people that you love. And there has to be a period where your imitation of them can become, you know, sort of too precise to the point where people genuinely ask whether you're original. And that's actually a natural product of what it is to learn an art form. The only problem comes if you're biting specific lyrics or specific songs. If you're biting a style, you can't patent a style. Obviously, you should give credit to where the style originated. And if you don't, that's a very bad look for you, because then you're trying to take credit for something that's not yours. But just to be influenced by a style is not a criticism, in my book at least, because that's really what it is to become great at an art form. A lot of times is to absorb many other people's styles. Anxious, I can feel it in my blood. All them late nights with that liquor in my cup. Two bottles down and I still don't get a buzz. All these chains on me got them thinking I'm the plug. Okay, okay, if you say so. Getting pounds, getting euros, getting pesos. And we did it by ourselves with no this dude is sick. And then we put our own people on a payroll. This dude is sick. I really like this dude. I never heard of this guy. How do you pronounce his name? Merkules? That makes a lot more sense. Yeah, I love the beats. The beats are beautiful. First things first, I'm the realest. Drop this and let the whole world feel it. Let them feel it. And I'm still in the murder business. I can hold you down like I'm giving lessons in physics. Right, right. You want a bad bitch like this. I wouldn't pay 99 cents for it. Again, it's not my kind of music. I don't really know what to say about it. She's fine. There has to be some appeal to her if she's that popular. Obviously, she's resonating with a lot of people. To me, I can't really say there's anything about her flow that resonates with me. If you're gonna argue she can't rap in an American accent, then you have to argue John Lennon couldn't sing in an American accent. And Queen couldn't sing We Will Rock You and We Are the Champions in an American accent. And if you're going to argue that, then f*** you, because you're wrong. Like, if you're actually going to be consistent about that, then there's so much amazing music you would have to pretend you dislike. The voice is an instrument, and just like with any instrument, you can do all kinds of things with it. You know, apply mutes and different kinds of ways of manipulating the sound. The voice is an instrument. Nobody who sings opera sounds like that. Nobody who ever has sang opera ever sounds like that when they talk. But that's the style. So if you love a style of music that isn't in the way that you talk, then you're just using your voice as an instrument. I don't see any principled reason to criticize her on those grounds. Everybody wanna tell me what I am, but I am not. Nah, you ain't black, you a motherfucking white boy. White shut boy. Your mouth, do a right boy. High boy, man, why you such a high boy? Hype. Why you always talk about being black? Being skin too white, nigga, fuck that. Nigga, fuck everything you talk about, cut that. Everything you that door you trying to open, you can shut that. Grip the gate, yeah, that's how I'ma fuck back. Tell me what I am and what I know now. All this prejudice has got to go. Life is moving fast, I need to slow down. Come and see me when I am in your town. Practice what we preach before it go down. Practice what we preach before it go. Logic is great. I mean, you can't say he can't rap. You can't say he can't rap or his music's not good, in my opinion. It's so interesting because he just does look white. That's the reality of him, is that he does look white. And so I totally understand why people object to him saying that he's black, because he just straight up looks white. But it raises very interesting questions about what the hell race is. You know, what does it mean to be black or white? He raises very crucial questions about what this whole skin color race thing is, that we're all walking around assuming is a totally real thing that has no sort of fluidity. It's interesting because we live in this era of absolutely questioning what gender is. Gender is, it's like the oldest division in human history, the most widely subscribed concept that every culture has agreed on almost since antiquity is that there are men and there are women. And sure, maybe there are men who dress this way and there are women who dress that way, but fundamentally there is this concept of men and women. Whereas race is kind of this much more fluid thing inherently. It's people of different races have all the same parts on the inside, they just are a different color, and yet we just act like it's this totally rigid concept that there are different types of people, that there are hard lines between them that can't be crossed, that you're either black or you're white. And I think it's interesting that logic just says, listen, fuck it, like, I'm black. I have black ancestry. I don't care that I look white. This is how I identify. He makes his critics justify their disagreement with him. And when they do that, they have to essentially kind of sound like Jim Crow people, like, you don't look this way, so you must be this race. It's like, listen, why can't we bring a dose of the fluidity that we're discovering about gender identity to race? That's a totally valid question. And his mere existence, the way he walks through the world, it provokes an answer in people. And I think that itself is a useful thing. Now before you walk in the door of this liquor store and try to get money out the drawer, you better think of the consequence. Who are you? I'm your mother conscience. That's nonsense. Go in, gas for the money and run to one of your aunt's cribs and borrow a damn dress to one of her blonde wigs. Telling you need a place to stay. You'll be safe for days if you shave your legs with Renee's razor blade. Eminem did it when there was no precedent for it. There was no precedent for a white rapper being recognized by the best black rappers of his day as one of the greats. He was the first to do it. No one did it before him. As far as bars go, he's still kind of unparalleled. Certainly there was a market in America that wanted a white rapper, but in terms of people in the hip hop industry and certainly black people, there was no desire to have a white rapper be one of the best. He was only ever fighting uphill in that sense. He was fighting uphill to get the respect of other rappers in the hip hop community, which he eventually did. So it was an uphill battle for him, right? And this is one of those situations where the wider narrative of white privilege, which is true in many cases, ends up misfiring because America is a very complicated country with very local dynamics. It can be true in many situations that white privilege is real, but it can also be true in a particular person's life or in a particular section of a person's life that they didn't have white privilege, that their whiteness was actually a barrier in a specific circumstance. Eminem is an example of that. When he showed up at the battle raps in Detroit, no one was like, oh, because he's white, we're going to give him, you know, the benefit of the doubt. No, it was the opposite. He had to win people over. He had to say, I know I'm white, but give me a chance. And people gave him a chance, and he's a virtuoso of hip hop. So obviously every white rapper in a way is indebted to him for proving to black people and to America in general that white people have something to contribute to hip hop, not just something to take from it. It makes sense that every serious white rapper would feel like they're in his shadow because in some sense they are. But at the same time, they're going to want to separate themselves from him, right? They're going to want to say, okay, I'm not Eminem. Here's how I'm different. Here's how I'm better. So I can't blame him for trying to do that. Unfortunately, it's kind of like a rock band trying to say they're better than the Beatles. It's like, it's just tough. When someone comes around once every few generations who just revolutionizes an art form, it's just very difficult. You can say you're better than them. You can say you're the best, but then people hear both of you back side to side, back to back, and it's tough to compete. The classics are classics for a reason. To me, the ultimate sign that he's influenced the rap world is the rappers, especially the black rappers that have been so directly influenced by him, like Tyler, the Creator. Tyler has his song Colossus, which is basically a replica or his version of Stan, which like follows the song exactly but applies to his life. And the whole thing of talking to your conscience, that's like, that's straight out of Goblin and Wolf. It's a remarkable achievement that he came into a culture that he was not from, but mastered the skills of an art form in that culture so well that people from that culture ended up being influenced by him. That's the ultimate sign, is when you're actually influencing people. He actually influenced hip hop. He influenced Kendrick Lamar. He influenced Earl Sweatshirt. He influenced a lot of people. Pretty much every rapper after him that is the kind of rapper that really cares about the technique and the bars, Eminem influenced. He also influenced pretty much anyone who's going for a kind of persona of like a fuck you persona. He influenced people not even in the genre of hip hop. So it's a remarkable achievement.